give them credit for. They just have to have things explained to them in a way that they understand. And the young people are thirsting for knowledge, and they're thirsting for a new and different way. So, yeah, in a way it is surprising, but in a way it's not. I think it's just human nature.
Speaking of young people, our resident young person, Shelley Roach, who deals with all the tweets that we get during the show, is seated next to me, and we'll jump in on the conversation. I'm sure that some of the young folks who tweet with you have some questions for Kane.
Sure they do. Here's one from Bird in Flight saying, Kane is in an amazing position to have a positive influence on the youth. They loved your letter to Chuck Norris. How do you start up conversations with some of your fans and some of the people that follow you to kind of get some of these concepts out there?
Well, it's become a little easier now since people sort of know where I stand, and I don't have to initiate the conversation. But and it's hard, of course. It's almost nearly impossible when you're talking with a total stranger. But a lot of times you have to get to know people a little bit. You can understand what makes them tick, of course. And if you can pick an area that they're not pleased with what the government's doing, and sometimes you have to wait a while. Sometimes they'll bring it up themselves. But if you can pick that area, you can sort of expand on things from there.
What's it like in the wrestling community? I mean, do you discuss, because I happen to believe, Kane, that everybody is a libertarian. Everybody wants to be able to do their own thing and essentially wants to be left alone. People in the government are not libertarians because freedom is an obstacle to them. It challenges them. It questions them. It looks for transparency. It makes them justify their behavior. But in all the people you deal with, professional wrestlers, colleagues, managers, fans, what do you find people are most thirsty for?
Well, from our standpoint, we are not subject to withholding tax. We have to pay our own federal income tax. So unlike most folks, we really know how much a chunk that takes out of our income. So a lot of the guys do pay attention to politics for that very reason. And I really think that in general, the thing that the people are most worried about is just the unbelievable spending spree that Washington has been on since the end of the Bush administration. I think that really bothers people, and rightly so.
Shelley, any questions or tweets for Kane?
Quite a few rolling in. Here's a suggestion from Jay Hansen. Could you adopt a new persona in the WWE that promotes liberty and freedom?
Well, we'll have to see. I don't know.
Okay.
All right. Okay. Where did Cain come from, by the way? What's the origin of that?
It's Cain and Abel.
Oh, okay.
Right.
All right. Shelley, any more questions for Cain?
What are some of your biggest influences? I know you were at the Mises Institute. What else has really influenced you in your freedom quest?
Well, yeah, the Mises Institute has been, and Austrian economics in general, has been a huge influence on me. The great thing about the Internet now is it is just a pipeline of information. It's a repository of information about any subject. A couple of the books that I recommend are Harry Brown's Why Government Doesn't Work, and also, of course, you have F.A. Hayek's The Road to Serfdom. I take bits and pieces from all sorts of different people about different things. For example, Judge Napolitano and his explanation of natural law and constitutional principles that are supposed to protect our natural rights, which are not given to us by government, but which are endowed by our Creator or a feature of our nature as human beings. So I'd say it's many, many various and different sources.
Do you discuss Austrian economics with other pro wrestlers? Because I would like to be a fly on the wall for those conversations, Kane.
Well, the thing about it, the beauty about Austrian economics is it's, you know, people have this misconception that economics is about numbers, and it's not.
It's about freedom.
The problem with that is you're leaving the human component completely out of the equation, and economics is the study of human action, and it's the study of really of cause and effect. Now, we're not sure what the effect's always going to be because it's dependent on what people do, But by the same token, it's not, you know, it's not a physics equation. So, and it's a verbal science. So you are able to discuss it with people and explain things in ways that they understand. And, you know, and all of a sudden light bulbs go off because, of course, that's the way things work. That's the way the world works.
Are you as distressed as I am at the first 125 days of the Obama administration, in which, following the Bush administration and its utter disregard for the natural law and constitutionally protected rights, it has destroyed freedom of contract, basically destroyed shareholder rights, basically said to bondholders and shareholders of corporation, you're going to take this, you're going to take that, said to shareholders, you can't have, for example, General Motors, Rick Wagner as chairman, we're going to fire him. Did you think that you would see the day, still in your youth, when we would be approaching this system of, I'll call it what it is, fascism, which is private ownership, but government control?
Well, that's exactly what it is, and it is very disturbing. The fact that central planners believe that they can succeed, and it's not a market failure. You know, some folks would say that they're succeeding where the market failed, but the market didn't fail. The market had lots of problems because the government intervened so much and the market couldn't operate freely. But, you know, from a constitutional perspective, too, Judge, every day when I read the news, it's Obama wants this. Obama promises that. Obama says this. But if you read the Constitution, Article 1, Section 1 said that all legislative powers shall be vested in Congress.
Right.
And it seems now we've moved to the point to where, and I think you'd agree that Congress is actually supposed to be the superior body. The President and the Supreme Court are supposed to be inferior bodies. They're supposed to be checks on the power of Congress. But we've moved to the point to where we have what Ludwig von Mises would call omnipotent government. I mean,
right.
You know, the President can virtually do anything that he wants, can say anything that he wants, and he's making law, and he's not supposed to do that. And of course, President Obama wasn't the first one. He's followed a precedent that has been set for him. But by the same token, it is very, very distressing.
Len, you're very eloquent, and you're very powerful, and you understand and explain this stuff so nicely. I really appreciate you coming. Would you promise me that the next time you're appearing anywhere around New York City, you'll come and visit us on Freedom Watch?
I will certainly try. What you guys are doing is a tremendous service, and I sincerely, you're making a difference.
Glenn Kane, Jacobs, thanks very much. Stay well, and we'll be watching for you. We are joined now by Congressman Otto Guevara from Costa Rica. Congressman Guevara, welcome to Freedom Watch.
Hello, how are you doing?
We're doing fine, thank you. Judge Napolitano here, along with my sidekick, Shelley Roche. We're coming to you from FoxNews.com in the middle of New York City. Where did we find you, Congressman?
I'm right now in San Jose, Costa Rica, in the middle of Central America.
What is the prospect for a libertarian revolution in Costa Rica as we speak? You've been fighting for this since you got home from Harvard Law School.
Yes, indeed. We formed the political party. It's called Movimiento Libertario back in 1994. And basically, there was a real battle in order to become to get a foot in Congress. That happened in 1998, and mainly because of the electoral system in Costa Rica of proportional representation. I got elected in 1998 as the only congressman of the Libertarian Party here in Costa Rica, and I stayed in Congress for 4 years. We don't have in Costa Rica consecutive re-election, and I've been the presidential candidate of that party in the last two elections, and right now I am preparing to my campaign for the next election in February year 2010. So we are about 8 months away from this election day, and we hope that in this next election, Costa Ricans will basically support freedom.
What's the state of the economy in Costa Rica? What's the state of economic freedom in Costa Rica, and what kind of obstacles are there for you making basic civil liberties and free market arguments?
It's been kind of difficult, and that's why we decided to form this Libertarian Party back in 1994, because Costa Rica has been a very socialist state with state-owned monopolies for